Hi, I'm here today with my dear friend, Rick Hayes. And he has decided to stop by my home and allow us to film a session of Conversations Among Friends. It's my joy and my pleasure to welcome him to my home. Thank you so much
for coming. Real pleasure to be here with you. It's been a while.
I know. But we had some time together yesterday. And when we did, well, the first thing that happened was when Rick walked in the house, he said, "You realize you have a presence here, an entity here?" And I said, "Yes, we're well aware of that." And then he proceeded to describe the man precisely, proceeded to start sharing some of this spirit's, disapproving comments regarding me. And my mouth in particular, didn't like the fact that there was any liquor on the wet bar, even though it's never used for anything except cooking. That didn't seem to matter, apparently. Didn't like the fact that we didn't have a garden in the backyard, because he always did. And told Rick that he had had a stroke, didn't die in the house, but this was his dream home, and he loved it here. And Rick got to know him, and we did film a little of that just on my phone, and I'll share that later. But I wanted to talk with Rick about this today, because so many people who know me and who have seen my videos know that I've said, we've got a spirit in this house, and events happen. George has been here when it's happened. My father has had numerous encounters. Let's start with that, and we'll talk about our spirit friend.
Well, as I shared with you yesterday, when I walked in the home, I felt, when I feel pressure, it also is sharing with me there's a presence in the room or in the home. And when I walked into your home, I felt that pressure immediately. And I define it as, if you go into a room with many people, you feel a difference in the pressure in a room than if you're in there by yourself. And that's exactly how I felt. And I walked in, and as we're sitting in your dining room area, and we're talking about just catching up, because it's been a while.
It has, too long.
Yes.
We won't let that happen again.
No. We got exciting things to come. But as we're sitting there, I've felt that presence of that male. I can tell the difference between a male and a female in spirit. And I felt the presence of a male walking up close to me. And as he walked up close to me, and again, understand that they do not go into my body, but they want me to understand their situation or what they experienced here in their life in the physical body. So as he began walking up toward me, he immediately made me feel numb on one side, and I felt that, and I felt very numb on that one side. And so as we began, I began sharing with you, we have a presence here, and you acknowledged that, yes, you already knew, so it wasn't no surprise to you. And I started describing him. One of the first things I shared with you, if you recall, Andrew, was that he was numbing my one side, was sharing with me. It was either, I felt a part of his life here he was experiencing, wanting me to understand the experience of his stroke, and on this side of the body. And then you validated to me that is how he transcended into spirit, was through a stroke. He then began expressing his personality. And, you know, even my feelings is, even when we transcend in spirit, the personality that we have created here makes it a part of us. And even if it's a dominating personality like himself, he's more at peace in the spirit body he's in now. But at the same time, he still has that bit of personality. And he began immediately sharing with me that, and I won't go into detail, but you were kind of expressing a current event. And
yes, I was.
A current political event that was expressing with like you do, with passion. And as you were doing that, I felt his presence, and he was he was almost like saying he didn't agree the way you had was expressing that's not what females do. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and then we begin more and more where we was discussing how his life, that the female in his, females in his life, or the female in his life, was more submissive, more the man was the ruler of the house, and the females were, you know, which I'm so happy to say, traditionally years ago, that was a part of life.
They acquiesced to the dominating male all the time. Yes, those days are long gone.
Thankfully. Because, you know, we talk later about our feelings is it's a partnership. But he went on to begin sharing with me about his feelings, about your thoughts. And then he started sharing other validations about himself. And as you shared, we was actually in your dining room, and he kept walking down another part of your home. And he went into, your foyer area. And he kept wanting me to understand there was something there that he did not approve of. And then he said, no alcohol here. And I looked at you and I asked you, I said, he doesn't like the alcohol in that part of the house. And that's when you said, well, we have a wine rack with wine on the bar.
On the wet bar,
which hasn't been opened.
Ever.
Even though I tried to have a glass.
The day is young, darling. The day is young.
But, you know, but again, just like with any, when I go into any home or any locations, I have an understanding that they want me to know about them. And they're not there to bring harm to me. They're wanting me to understand why they're here, why they choose to be here in your home. As you shared earlier, this home was his dream home. He had a lot of pride in his home. But we also, through communication with them, have given him a better understanding. You're the owner of the home. You own the home now. And I know you had some physical signs or physical triggers, that he has shown you physically that he's here. So we talked to him about, you don't need to be doing that anymore. Mm-hmm. And I'll just share this that when we had completed and I went to the rest in one of your restrooms and I was back there, it doesn't matter where you're at.
Which is a little unnerving to me, actually, because when I close that bathroom door and get in the shower, I'd like to think I was alone.
I have a tendency a lot to say, show me some respect, but I was in there and immediately I heard his voice and I heard him say, I'm glad we told her now. And so with that, it gave me an understanding and an impression that he understood that he was able to relay the messages to Andrea and let her know, number one, that he is here, number two, he chooses to be here, and number three, this was how he felt about his own philosophy of life and how his experiences in life growing up and in this home and as an adult. And I guess the key on that statement was he was almost satisfied that we had communicated with him and communicated together with him. And it gave him a sense of, I respect her more now. And as I shared with you just a few minutes ago when I came into your home, the air is lighter. It is different than yesterday. And I feel like it has a lot to do with the sense that he understands you, and you understand him now, and there's an equality there more than it was before.
I've had a couple of incidents where I've seen, as I shared with you, full body apparition, an almost opaque shadow, and I said that to you yesterday, and said it seems as though he was a smaller man, not very tall, and a bit hunched over, and then you immediately responded about his body language when you saw him in the parlor and how he was sitting and how rigid and stern he was. But that when he walks, he communicated with you that he suffered terribly from arthritis,
right.
Probably osteoporosis.
Right.
And so I think that would account for the stooped over apparition that I've seen repeatedly in the house. I thank you for reminding him that he doesn't need to make so much noise in this house in the wee hours of the morning that I think that the house is being broken into. I appreciate the fact that he wants to make his presence known. I respect the fact that this was his house first. And I always show respect for the dead. You know that.
Yes.
I agree with you that they retain certain characteristics when they pass. But I will also pretty much tell you that by the time I'm done with him, he'll be a feminist. I'm going to educate this spirit about the power and presence of this woman in this house. I've never had any altercations with him, but one thing that did happen that I shared with you yesterday was a couple of months ago when Dad was right there at the bar and he was paying bills. We have one of those Oster blenders, the old-fashioned kind, heavy glass, and it turned on high. Yeah, and it takes something to press that button. It takes a significant amount of energy to press that button, and my father screamed. I was in my office at the time. I came running, and you know, if our spirit objects to my occasional language and my political outbursts, especially about a certain candidate that I have no tolerance for, then he really got an education that day, because my dad freaked when that happened to him. The poor thing. George has been here when all those beautiful ornamental copper pots that are up on top of the very flat, very wide refrigerator. George just came flying off the refrigerator while George and I were talking about what? Ghosts and spirits, demonology, blah, blah, blah. We were just having a normal conversation in the kitchen, and everything came flying in a split second off the top of that refrigerator. It wasn't unbalanced. It was perfectly stable, and it's as if he just went, phoom, gone. But the thing that's so interesting, and something that happened to us at the farmhouse quite a bit too, was that objects would go flying and would hit walls or hit floors or hit windows, but nothing would chip, nothing would break, nothing would dent. And I'm interested to hear your perspective about that, because the inference is that it's happening in an alternate dimension, and therefore there's no damage done per se. Mm-hmm. But I know you're very familiar with cases like this, mm-hmm. and I want your perspective on that.
Okay. Well, first of all, as you know, I'm Rick Hayes, so I just share with you what I feel. I don't try to follow anyone else. I'm just me. So my thoughts, I used to say for years, Andrea, I used to say, I believe, and now I'm truly saying I know. And I'm not being egotistical in that sense. It's just that after the years, almost 15 years of in the industry and the public, and the many experiences I've had, it's becoming from I think to I believe to I know. And one of the areas is that we have a tendency to be frightened about is when we receive what I call the physical validations or the signs and mm-hmm. things flying across the room. And my feelings on most experiences I've had and going to cases like that is that they're not trying to harm you. They're just trying to say, I'm here. They're trying to get your attention in some way. And I use the example of if a baby's in a high chair and it wants a bottle on the table, but it can't reach the bottle. And the mom comes later because the baby is crying and screaming, and the mother is not paying attention to the baby. Then eventually what the baby's going to do out of frustration is she brings over a bowl of cereal and lays it on there. That's not what he wants. The baby wants the bottle of milk. It will throw... He'll pick it up and throw it on the floor. And it's the same way with those that are in the next part of their life. They're wanting us at times to know they're around. And so what they'll do is they'll give us the validations that you shared, the plates coming across the room, things like amplifying. And the reason we often say, why didn't it break? Well, the reason is because it has a lot to do with the energy itself. If they have a tendency to take that energy, and by the way, everything is made up of energy, and so if they have a tendency to take that plate and have the energy to throw it, they also have the energy to make where it does not break, and it gets even more attention to you because you look at the plate and say, how did that go across the room and hit that wall and it didn't break? There's got to be something more than just a coincidence here. And so that, to me, is it all has to do with the energy and the controlling of the energy, even of the plate of the energy. So that, to me, is why we get a lot of those signs. And I express to everyone, pay more attention to those, because what they're doing is they want you to know that there's another part of life, and they want you to know that they choose to be around you. And so that's why we get those type of, to me, that's why they get those, I know, that's why we get those type of signs like that.
I too have made the transition that you have. Mm-hmm. I went from I think to I believe to I know. And there is a huge spectrum between these three. Mm-hmm. And the largest leap is the leap of faith between I believe and I know.
Yes.
And it takes a kind of spiritual courage to even utter those words. And yet both of us do it with such conviction, such confirmation of our own experiences. I love how you refer to the next part of life rather than after death. Because I too believe, as you do, that we are all energy. Everything is energy. Energy does not disperse. It does not. It only transmutes. And so as it reconfigures itself, death is not the end, right, but merely the beginning of the next part of life. Do you think that spirit has any sense of time or space per se? And I'll ask you this for a reason.
Okay.
When we left the farmhouse, we thought that we would be leaving the spirits behind. And nothing could have been further from the truth. Attachments were formed. They were profound. They were lifelong. When I arrived in Georgia with my family, most of my family, Cindy was already there. And when we pulled into the yard of the new house in Cherokee County, there was an apparition standing behind her. Now, this was a new house. There was no way anything was left behind there.
Can you hold that thought for a moment? I just yes. had your...
Oh, yes. No doubt.
He just
really?
Tapped me on the shoulder.
Okay.
And his words to you was, I am here. So he wants me to acknowledge himself to you today, and he's here. And just to share with you, I see them, I hear them. The way I see them is what we're talking about, the energy. I'm hearing him right now. The way I see them the majority of the times is an elongated light, very bright in the center. I also see him in a shadow form as well. I also see him in a full body in certain times. With him, I felt his presence come up. I felt him tap me on the shoulder, and he said, I am here. So he wants you to know that he's here, okay? Mm-hmm. So go ahead. I'm sorry, but
no,
when they
okay.
come up and say hello, I
and
acknowledge
I want
him.
To know if he knows what year this is.
And again, this is his personality. He relayed to me, he says, why wouldn't I know what year it is?
Okay.
And to answer what you were sharing, and I apologize again for interrupting,
no,
but
not at all.
They do know, and I love what you said. I keep the word death and dead out of my vocabulary just because if you look up the definition of that, it means an end. We don't end. We simply transcend from this part of our learning experience in life, and we go to the next part of our learning experience in life. We just transcend to a different body form. But this gentleman is being he's very respectful of me, but because we met yesterday, he knows me a little more. But I just said that just to let you know. He said, you think you know everything. He said that to me. So just to let you know that. So you don't have to be a feminist for him to give you.
Well,
that was just that's his personality.
It's his personality.
Exactly.
He took exception to your lovely long hair.
Yes, he
yesterday.
Did. Yes, he did. He made a little comment about my hair being a little bit too long in his style. So I could have very easily responded and said, well, maybe there was a little bit of jealousy there because the way I visualized you, didn't have much at all. So
that sounds like jealousy to me.
But, yeah, I mean, he's... Okay, I want to answer your question on time. He wants you to know that he's an intelligent man.
I know
and
that.
And he's expressing that to you. But they have an understanding of time because they are a part of this. So they understand the time, the year. But they're also in a part of life where time is not man-made. You know, we created time. We created by defining time by years, days, months, seconds, and minutes. Where in that part of life, it is an eternal part. So there is no reason, basically, to communicate with time at all. But they're fully aware. It's just like, this is my second time in your home to visit with you. Yesterday, I had no correlation at all of where your rooms were until you showed us around. I came in today. I knew which room to go into because I've been here before. It's the same thing with time with them. They know the time frame we're in. That doesn't mean they're in that time frame, but they're observing and they understand the time frame we're in.
You're known all over the world as one of the preeminent mediums, one of the preeminent psychics on this planet. Did that proclivity come to you at birth and you just nurtured it? And essentially, were you born this way? I think we're all spiritual beings.
Yes.
That transmute into a physical experience so that we can be on this plane of action to learn our lessons, and then we ultimately return to the spiritual realm. But do you believe that you came prepared and with your gifts at birth, or is this a marked proclivity that developed as you aged?
No, I do believe that when we're created on this earth in the form of a physical body, the spirit goes into the physical body, that we are given many gifts in life, including the gifts of what I'm sharing is the gift of knowing that there is a life continual. And so I recognized it early. My memory can only take me back to a certain age, which had been around 4, maybe 5 years old. I was raised in a very traditional church upbringing. My grandfather was a very highly respected evangelist in his career here. But at the same time, just like because of society and because of traditional beliefs, I had to maintain these abilities to myself. I've had them all my life, and I maintained them to myself until it's been 15 years now. I can't believe it. Mm-hmm. 15 years. But 15 years ago, I heard this. I heard, it's time. And so that was...
I did too.
I had a feeling you did. I really do.
The day I started writing the trilogy, it's like... It's old-fashioned alarm clocks went off in my head. You know the kinds with the big bells on them, the big round ones, and they literally move when they ring? And I heard that in my head, and I heard the words, it's time. And I went to the calendar, and I wrote down on August 7th, 2007, and so it begins.
And we spoke yesterday. The journey is going to be amazing, and we've spoken about the amount of the time going to be happening, and it's time. You may have heard that. You're hearing this from me as well. It's time. So it's a perfect time, actually. So it's the same thing with me. I mean, the last 15 years, I realize more and more every day, first of all, every individual that's walking on this earth has a purpose in life.
Agreed.
And each has a unique purpose in life. And it could be something as nothing, it could be something as essential as raising children. It could be something as essential as being a doctor. It could be something as essential as sharing unique abilities. But we all have a unique purpose in life. And so 15 years ago, I was told it's time. I knew this was my life purpose at that time. And for the last 15 years, it's been my life purpose. And it's been a phenomenal 15 years. Every experience you experience in life is sharing with you, this is a part of your purpose. And even though you may not understand it, it's part of your purpose. And so you're on your purpose.
And speaking of that, I've shared with you personally that I walked around this planet for decades going, why am I here? What is this? It feels so unfamiliar to me. Beautiful, but so unfamiliar to me. I really did feel like a misfit. I was as social a creature as I am. Emotionally, I was very reclusive. I was very studious. I did a lot of writing, obviously in preparation for what I have produced since I actually began the trilogy. But I felt very lonely. I felt moments of terrible despair. I felt like I was accidentally placed here. And when I finished the trilogy, I went through what I described to you yesterday as postpartum depression after birthing the triplets. And then that's when George bailed me out within a flicker, which mm-hmm. I will always be grateful for. But I now have a sense of purpose on this planet that is a realization that has come to me only in the last 4 or 5 years. And now I feel completely at ease in my skin. Was there a time where you felt dis-ease, and then as you accepted your role, that dissipated for you as well?
Yes, and it is, and I will respond to your emotions that you went through. The emotions you go through are, again, I look at them as learning lessons. You don't know what it is to feel depressed or feel sadness until you experience it. And it's the same thing with communication with those in spirit. You really don't understand it till you experience it. And the more you experience it, the more you understand it. Same thing with, we are created to experience emotions because it's a learning lesson. That comes from joy, that comes from sadness. Every emotion is a learning experience. For me, we're like going down the same path in a way, because you was talking about that, and I recall growing up, and I wanted to be just like everyone else. In my mind, I wanted to be a regular kid, and so I just kept these abilities to myself, and even we just didn't talk about them until I had moments where it was expressing me, but again, 15 years ago was the door that opened and said, it's time for you to share. I was a little bit concerned how it's going to be responded, because is everybody going to think there's something wrong with me, or is everyone going to think, should he be checked out, you know, yeah. medically? But I realized the more and more and more that, and it doesn't have to do with growing your reputation, it has to right. do with knowing what you have, knowing what mm-hmm. the abilities you've been blessed yes. with. And the more, and that creates the confidence, and that creates really positive energy that just gives you that level of do not fear, mm-hmm. be confident in what you've been given.
Yeah.
And that's what has been with me for the last 15 years. Yes, growing up, it was, I'm worried about what so-and-so is going to think if I say anything. I'm worried about they'll take me to the doctors. Maybe there's something medically wrong.
And that happens a lot yes. to gifted children.
Yes. But, you know, I get more confident every day. And it's a positive confidence, in the sense of, just like we're talking here, this gentleman walked up. You know, they're watching us on film. They're probably saying, there's nobody there. Yes, there's somebody
yes, there.
And I'm
there.
Confident that's to that share is. With you there's someone there. So. And that has to do with, in one of my books I wrote, and I actually borrowed this from someone famous, the only fear you have is fear itself.
Yes.
And I was relaying it to the spiritual side of life. And I kind of expanded on that a little bit. I said, the only fear you have is fear itself, but to understand will eliminate the fear. And if you mm-hmm. think about it, the more you understand something, even with your own abilities, the more you understand, the less fearful you become. Mm-hmm. Where eventually it's eliminated.
It's not only eliminated, but in embracing it, understanding that it serves a purpose, that it is meant to be a tool for us, not a dictator to
right.
us. I think that in the embracing comes the dispelling of the fear, and therefore our ultimate liberation. I feel completely free now, where I used to be reticent, reluctant to share my feelings, reluctant to share anything spiritual, anything having to do with the farm. I went for 30 years without telling my closest friends that I grew up in one of the most haunted houses in the world. And now I tell everybody. And the interesting thing is that people who read the trilogy that I wrote, House of Darkness, House of Light, when they finish it, they
Which
write
you should.
To me.
You should read those.
Yes. Oh, thank you.
Absolutely.
they tell me that it liberates them to share their own experiences. It's almost as if, because during the reading of the trilogy, they experience every human emotion, it opens that door for them as well. And so, ultimately, its purpose is not only to educate and to inform and to enlighten, but also to liberate.
And if you recall, my friend, we met several years ago, and I think you had just finished the first book of the trilogy.
Yes.
And I came up to you, and we talked, and you was you signed one of my books, one of the books, the book, and you signed it. And I kind of took you, and I said, looked right at you, and I said, "So when are you writing the next one?" And you looked at me, and you literally grabbed me by the arm. You took me away from, because we was at an event. You took me away from everyone. You said, "How did you know about that book? The next book I'm writing. I'm writing another book. How do you?" I said, "You got three." And you looked at me and you said, "I do. I don't know if I'll get. I think the second book's the finished one." I said, "No, you have three." And the reason I felt that is because what we're talking about here today, it is because it was a part of your purpose to share with everyone. You had restricted yourself because of those around you, the environment you was in, to share because of the fear of what everyone would feel. Same thing with my abilities. But when the time came, mm-hmm. it was the door opened and said, "This is your purpose. This is for you to share." And that was the part of the three book series. Mm-hmm. I knew she was writing the three books before she did.
You called me a couple of years ago and said, "How's your mom?" And I hadn't put anything out anywhere that my mother had fallen and broken her hip. Mm-hmm. And I say, I shouldn't have been shocked. I excuse me for having been shocked, but I said, "Oh, she's doing much better, Rick. Thank you so much for asking. How did you know? That's a really stupid question." And you said it was her right hip, and I said, "No, I think it was her left." I had a moment of confusion, and you said, "No, absolutely not. It's her right hip." And my mother could hear me on the phone. She's like, "Who are you talking to? What's going on out there?" So of course I had to share with her. But when we were together in Waverly, Ohio at the Emmett House, which has sadly burned to the ground under suspicious circumstances, sadly, what a great loss to the community, historically significant building, right on what was the Erie Canal. You had a conversation with me that I'll never forget, and you said to me, "You'll do very well with the trilogy. In fact, you're the first one that ever referred to it as a trilogy," because I didn't have any intention of going beyond two books. And you said, "You'll do very well and you will become known worldwide because of those three books, but it's the fourth one that will explode."
I remember that now.
Christopher Moon was sitting adjacent to us, mm-hmm. and he was kind of, you know, watching what was going on. And and he leaned over to me. You don't know this, but he leaned over to me afterwards and he said, "Rick's right."
That, I didn't know that part. Mm-hmm. Wow. And just to share with you, the reason I shared that with you also, I'm one of those in this industry that is also known for the positive energy. And even the messages I receive, you talking about your mom, it's my responsibility when I receive these messages not to share them in a negative light, but to share them in a positive light. So I received the message, I'm sure, I don't recall the time, but I'm sure I received the message about your mother was going through something medically, and they gave me a little more detail about it, but it was for me to share with you that to spend time with her and to be there for her and support her through this, and everything will be okay. And that's, you know, with your books and with your experiences that you've encountered, even though you could had the vision of what Andrea and her family went through in this trilogy was negative, you have taken that and you have changed it, that experience, into a positive, because it's given individuals something to read and understand more about this life and the life, what I call the life continual. And so I'm just so proud of her.
I'm proud of you, and I appreciate what you do for everyone who
Thank you
has
so much.
The pleasure and privilege to encounter you in life. I would like you to take a moment to let our viewers know how to be in contact with you and what exactly you do. I know you mentioned that not only do you function fully as a psychic medium, but that you're also branching out now more into life coaching in a larger way. And you do bring so many gifts and so much innate understanding of life. I can imagine how incredibly helpful that is for so many people. But I would like our viewers to be able to reach you in ease.
Well, just with anything, when you realize your purpose and you realize that this is the purpose and this is the reason why you were given certain abilities, you find as you're going along your path that certain doors will open and say, this is a part of it as well. You need to walk through that. When I speak in colleges, I share with our future generation, the young adults, that, you know, when a door opens for you, it's not for you to stand there and say, why did that door open?
Right.
It's for you to walk through. It's guiding you. It's bringing you opportunities.
Say yes to the universe.
Exactly. So, you know, my beginnings was private consultations, and then it branched out to speaking and writing books and television and film. But as I was going through my first few years of being out in the public with this, I was getting so many individuals that were very, very satisfied and happy and enjoy and change of belief that there is more than just life here and their loved ones are around us. But I found out more and more, Andrew, that they were starting to ask me about their life here, about what is my purpose in life? Or my marriage, is it going to be okay? And I don't feel comfortable in the job I'm in now. I feel like I'm stuck. Well, this was little doors opening for me and sharing with me, Rick, you need to learn this because this is a part of life as well. Mm-hmm. And so about 4.5 years ago, I really started. I always share with everyone, you listen to the experts in your field when I'm doing missing cases or cold cases. You listen to the law enforcement. They're the experts. If you have a medical situation, you go to the medical doctors. And because they're the experts. So I really, about 4.5 years ago, I really started studying because I felt there was a need there. Started studying with those top in their field in life coaching and just learning from them, because learning is a great part of life, and just learning from them. And then I developed my own, the program that we have had now for about the last year. The program is called Life Directions. I'm really enjoying it. It is a one-on-one 90-day program for those in consultation. Give you a quick example of that. I have an individual that she was in the medical field for over 17 years, very an executive level. She was let go right before the program started. And I asked her, I said, what is your purpose in life? What do you want to do in life? And she said, I've always wanted to go to Abu Dhabi and work over there in the medical field. And I said, you're going to make it happen. You just put it out there. You put the energy out there. You're going to make it happen. 30 days after the end of the 9-day program, she contacted me and she said, you're not going to believe this, but I've been accepted to go to Abu Dhabi.
Of course you believed it. Of course you
did. I said, I didn't believe it. I knew it. But she's in the process now of preparing to go to Abu Dhabi. So, you know, that program is just a part of not just sharing with the messages from those in spirit around us about life, but also it is a program to share with you. You have a purpose in life. Each and every one of you have a purpose in life. Each and every one of you have a reason why you're experiencing and growing and learning here in life. And these are just tools to apply. The biggest tool in that whole program is, again, going back to removing the fear and elevating your confidence and getting all your 8 elements in your life balanced, and then things start manifesting to create for
you. Yes, I agree. And I think that it's actually tapping in to our central being, which I think is a manifestation of pure love, of God consciousness. Tapping into that is what gives us enormous power. And, you know, I talk about this as I lecture around the country too. Mm-hmm. And there's this concept that's been floating around for a while called cosmic ordering and speaking to the universe cosmic ordering, not like I order you to give me what I want, but I'm placing my order here. And the universe will always work to accommodate us, to address our needs. Sometimes it will give us more than we expected. Sometimes it will seem as though it's withholding, and yet it's because while we're busy planning our specific path, there's so much greater that's waiting for us and coming to us. So it's, I talk to people about interacting, you know, being part of understanding that all life matters. I think that one of the reasons why there's so much anger and discontent in the world is because people feel insignificant. Mm-hmm. They feel like they just don't matter, that they're lost in the fray, that they're just a number, that their life has no purpose and meaning. And when you tap into that purpose and meaning, it is the most empowering thing that you can do as an individual. Now, I have one more important question for you, and you are going to... I'm interested to see how you react. I've talked to a number of psychics, self-proclaimed psychics, over my travels. You know, I go to all these different paracons and run into an awful lot of people. Most of the time when I ask this question, most of the time, well, that's just not the way it works.
Okay.
But I did ask this question of Tiffany Rice, and I got an amazing response, and I want to know she is a great lady, and I want to know if your response is similar. Let me preface it.
Okay.
If there's such a thing as a medium, if there's such a thing as someone who is able to tap into the spirit world and communicate with the spirit world, then that all happens and exists on the same plane of action, simultaneously and multidimensionally. If there's such a thing as a psychic, as you know, as our proclivity to label everything is, a psychic is known as someone who can literally project into the future. Now, if there is such a thing as a psychic, and you are capable of projecting into the future to see what will come in any given situation with any given individual, does that not necessitate the existence of multi-dimensions where everything that's happening now has already happened for you to be able to see it?
I will respond in my way.
Okay.
I do feel that when we're created on this earth in a physical body, that we have a path that has already been determined. Certain experiences we learn from, certain things we're going to grow from, and certain things we're going to experience from. We also have what I call the gift of choice. We have the gift of choice. Just because a psychic says your tire's going to be flat next Thursday on your vehicle doesn't necessarily mean that tire's going to be flat next Thursday. The reason why is because you are now have a better understanding that you may have a tendency of having a flat tire next Thursday. Your tire may be worn. This is going to give you the choice, the opportunity to change that tire. So we have, you know, we were just talking over lunch this afternoon, about a month or so ago, is 3 days before it happened. I was asked about something, and I shared that I was seeing a plane going down, and I said, this is going to be very soon. For some reason, I get what I call picture postcards. They're actually visualizations, but I got a picture of the Middle East. There was a connection to the Middle East, and I said, all on the plane will move on. And I think it was 2 days later, the Egypt Air.
In the Mediterranean.
Yeah. Yep. And so the response to that is, if you got that, why did that happen? Was it predetermined? Was it already meant to be? It has a lot to do with an individual's choice. Being on the plane, for example, it has a lot to do with how we interact and react with the things that are ahead in our path. Is it different? Is it different dimensions? In a sense, yes. Does it still intertwine? Yes, because life is all one. So
if everything is one thing, then all thing is existence.
Exactly. Exactly. So, you know, when I received that as a psychic, because I'm titled, I tell everyone, they call me in this industry a psychic medium or medium psychic. Just call me dinner. Just call Rick Hayes dinner. I'm happy. Okay.
But, call me for dinner.
That's right. So, but, you know, it was my, when I received that, it was my responsibility to share it. And if in some way, if it was meant to be, for me to share that publicly in some way to help those in that dimension, in that part of the dimension in the future, then it was, I would have been given that opportunity. It's sad to receive what we call psychic visualizations ahead, because you almost feel like you're responsible that you need to change it in some way.
Yes.
I feel like we are given responsibility to, given that responsibility and that opportunity to change that. Mm-hmm. In that case, it was a part of another dimension that we just let things happen. What did we learn from it? That's what I share. When we get individuals ask, why do we have these tsunamis? Why do we have, you know, the terrorist acts? Why do we get these things? It all comes down to one thing. It's sad, it's tragic, but for every challenge we receive in life, there's a reward. So just think about your own individual life. When you're having a bad day or you've had something tragic in your life, look at the reward, the learning you learned from that. In some way, reward. I've had so many individuals that will share with me, you know, they went through a tragedy, but the family has since then has gotten so much closer.
Yes.
That's a reward, you know. Mm-hmm. It saddened us, but there's a reward from that. So I don't know if I answered your question or not, but...
No, you did.
Okay.
I think you have a very clear understanding that life is a series of lessons, and the test always seems to come before the lesson. It really is an amazing journey that we're on, a truly sacred
and
spiritual journey.
And yes. It intertwines. It really does.
It does.
Those in spirit, is that part of life, is they're in that part of life, we're in this part of life, but we intertwine. Mm-hmm. Just like this gentleman here, you know, he's in the next part of his life, you're in this part of this life, but your life is intertwined with each other because you chose this home, you chose to take ownership of this home, at just as he did years ago. He made it his dream home. You'll make it your home to dream in. Mm-hmm. And you're intertwining with one another. That's the focus and that's the key.
And it's all energy.
It is all energy. It sounds mystical, you know, that it's energy.
It's actual.
It is
scientific.
Life. It is life.
It is. It is the nature of life.
Mm-hmm.
I love you with all my heart. You are an exceptional, extraordinary human being.
Thank you.
I am blessed to call you my friend, and we are truly kindred spirits.
We are kindred and we're connected.
Yes.
I don't know if you recall this, but the first time we met, it was my feeling was, I felt like I've known you for hundreds of years. You know, mm-hmm. This first time we had seen each other and met each other, and we immediately connected, and I thought, that's that energy. That's that energy
exactly
intertwining.
Right. It's this.
Yeah. So
it is.
It's such a pleasure to be in the hospitality of your home. I can't thank you enough for this opportunity. And again, this lady right here is one special individual, one special energy. And look for, you have some exciting things coming up.
I'm so proud of you. Thank you.
Thank you
for joining
me here
today. Love you, sweetheart.
Love you.
Thank you for joining us. This is the first of what will be a series of conversations among friends.
I'm the first.
You are the first.
First.
Thank you for joining us today.